The Menace of the Religious Movie by A.W. Tozer. When God gave to Moses the blueprint of the tabernacle, he was careful to include every detail. Then, lest Moses should get the notion that he could improve on the original plan, God warned him solemnly, "And look that thou make them after their pattern, which was shown thee in the mount." God, not Moses, was the architect. To decide the plan was the prerogative of the deity. No one dare alter it so much as a hair's breadth. The New Testament church also is built after a pattern. Not the doctrines only, but the methods are divinely given. The doctrines are expressly stated in so many words. Some of the methods followed by the early New Testament church had been given by direct command. Others were used by God's specific approval, having obviously been commanded the apostles by the Spirit. The point is that when the New Testament canon was closed, the blueprint for the age was complete. God has added nothing since that time. From God's revealed plan, we depart at our peril. Every departure has two consequences, the immediate and the remote. The immediate touches the individual and those close to him. The remote extends into the future to unknown times, and may expand so far as to influence for evil the whole church of God on earth. The temptation to introduce new things into the work of God has always been too strong for some people to resist. The church has suffered untold injury at the hands of well-intentioned but misguided persons who have felt that they know more about running God's work than Christ and his apostles did. A solid train of boxcars would not suffice to haul away the religious truck which has been brought into the service of the church with the hope of improving on the original pattern. These things have been, one and all, positive hindrances to the progress of the truth and have so altered the divinely planned structure that the apostles, were they to return to earth today, would scarcely recognize the misshapen thing which has resulted. Our Lord, while on earth, cleansed the temple, and periodic cleansings have been necessary in the Church of God throughout the centuries. Every generation is sure to have its ambitious amateur to come up with some shiny gadget which he proceeds to urge upon the priests before the altar. That the Scriptures do not justify its existence does not seem to bother him at all. It is brought in anyway and presented in the very name of orthodoxy. Soon, it is identified in the minds of the Christian public with all that is good and holy. Then, of course, to attack the gadget is to attack the truth itself. This is an old familiar technique, so often and so long practiced by the devotees of error that I marvel how the children of God can be taken in by it. We of the evangelical faith are in the rather awkward position of criticizing Roman Catholicism for its weight of unscriptural impedimenta, and at the same time tolerating in our own churches a world of religious fribble as bad as holy water or the elevated host. Heresy of method may be as deadly as heresy of message. Old-line Protestantism has long ago been smothered to death by extra-scriptural rubbish. Unless we of the gospel churches wake up soon, we shall most surely die by the same means. Within the last few years, a new method has been invented for imparting spiritual knowledge, or to be more accurate, it is not new at all, but is an adaptation of a gadget of some years' standing, one which by its origin and background belongs not to the church, but to the world. Some within the fold of the church have thrown their mantle over it, have blessed it with a text, and are now trying to show that it is the very gift of God for our day. But however eloquent the sales talk, it is an unauthorized addition nevertheless, and was never a part of the pattern shown us on the Mount. I refer, of course, to the religious movie. For the motion picture as such, I have no irrational allergy. It is a mechanical invention merely, and is in its essence amoral. That is, it is neither good nor bad, but neutral. With any physical object or any creature lacking the power of choice, it could not be otherwise. Whether such an object is useful or harmful depends altogether upon who uses it and what he uses it for. No moral quality attaches where there is no free choice. Sin and righteousness lie in the will. The motion picture is in the same class as the automobile, the typewriter, or the radio, a powerful instrument for good or evil, depending upon how it is applied. For teaching the facts of physical science, the motion picture has been useful. The public schools have used it successfully to teach health habits to children. The Army employed it to speed up instruction during the war. That it has been of real service within its limited field is freely acknowledged here. Over against this is the fact that the motion picture in evil hands has been a source of moral corruption to millions. No one who values his reputation as a responsible adult will deny that the sex movie and the crime movie have done untold injury to the lives of countless young people in our generation. The harm lies not in the instrument itself, but in the evil will of those who use it for their own selfish ends. I am convinced that the modern religious movie is an example of the harmful misuse of a neutral instrument. There are sound reasons for my belief. I am prepared to state them. That I may be as clear as possible, let me explain what I do and do not mean by the religious movie. I do not mean the missionary picture, nor the travel picture, which aims to focus attention upon one or another section of the world's great harvest field. These do not come under consideration here. By the religious movie, I mean that type of motion picture which attempts to treat spiritual themes by dramatic representation. These are, as their advocates dare not deny, frank imitations of the authentic Hollywood variety. But the truth requires me to say that they are infinitely below their models, being mostly awkward, amateurish, and from an artistic standpoint, hopelessly and piteously bad. These pictures are produced by acting a religious story before the camera. Take, for example, the famous and beautiful story of the prodigal son. This would be made into a movie by treating the narrative as a scenario. Stage scenery would be set up. Actors would take the roles of father, prodigal son, elder brother, etc. There would be plot, sequence, and dramatic denouement, as in the ordinary tearjerker shown at the Bijou movie house on Main Street in any one of 1,000 American towns. The story would be acted out, photographed, run onto reels, and shipped around the country to be shown for a few wherever desired. The service where such a movie would be shown might seem much like any other service until time for the message from the Word of God. Then the lights would be put out and the picture turned on. The message would consist of this movie. What followed the picture would, of course, vary with the circumstances. But often an invitation song is sung and a tender appeal is made for erring sinners to return to God. Now, what is wrong with all this? Why should any man object to this or go out of his way to oppose its use in the house of God? Here is my answer. 1. It violates the scriptural law of hearing. The power of speech is a noble gift of God. In his ability to open his mouth and by means of words make his fellows know what is going on inside his mind, a man shares one of the prerogatives of the Creator. In its ability to understand the spoken word, the human mind rises unique above all the lower creation. The gift which enables a man to translate abstract ideas into sounds is a badge of his honor as made in the image of God. Written or printed words are sound symbols and are translated by the mind into hearing. Hieroglyphics and ideograms were, in effect, not pictures but letters, and the letters were agreed-upon marks which stood for agreed-upon ideas. Thus, words, whether spoken or written, are a medium for the communication of ideas. This is basic in human nature and stems from our divine origin. It is significant that when God gave to mankind his great redemptive revelation, he couched it in words. And God spake all these words, very well sums up the Bible's own account of how it got here. "Thus saith the Lord" is the constant refrain of the prophets. "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life," said our Lord to his hearers. Again he said, "He that heareth my word, and believeth on him that sent me, hath everlasting life." Paul made words and faith to be inseparable. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And he also said, "How shall they hear without a preacher?" Romans 10:14. Surely it requires no genius to see that the Bible rules out pictures and dramatics as media for bringing faith and life to the human soul. The plain fact is that no vital spiritual truth can be expressed by a picture. Actually, all any picture can do is to recall to mind some truth already learned through the familiar medium of the spoken or written word. Religious instruction and words are bound together by a living cord and cannot be separated without fatal loss. The Spirit himself, teaching soundlessly within the heart, makes use of ideas previously received into the mind by means of words. If I am reminded that modern religious movies are sound pictures making use of the human voice to augment the dramatic action, the answer is easy. Just as far as the movie depends upon spoken words, it makes pictures unnecessary. The picture is the very thing that differentiates between the movie and the sermon. The movie addresses its message primarily to the eye, and to the ear only incidentally. Were the message addressed to the ear, as in the scriptures, the picture would have no meaning and could be omitted without loss of the intended effect. Words can say all that God intends them to say, and this they can do without the aid of pictures. According to one popular theory, the mind receives through the eye 5 times as much information as the ear. As far as the external shell of physical facts is concerned, this may hold good. But when we come to spiritual truth, we are in another world entirely. In that world, the outer eye is not too important. God addresses his message to the hearing ear. "We look," says Paul, "not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." 2 Corinthians 4:18. This agrees with the whole burden of the Bible, which teaches us that we should withdraw our eyes from beholding visible things and fasten the eyes of our hearts upon God while we reverently listen to his uttered words. "The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thine heart." That is the word of faith which we preach. Romans 10:8. Here, and not somewhere else, is the New Testament pattern, and no human being and no angel from heaven has any right to alter that pattern.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?